All right, so let's go there. Overseer. You need a little clarity? Check the similarity.
And that is the real deal, because we've gone from dealing with the overseers on the plantation to some of these officers that think we're still on the plantation. You need to check out the similarities to get the clarity. That's what we're fighting right now.
That is a fact.
I'm from New York, and I know where it all started with KRS-One and you and others. This struggle started in the streets. It didn't start in the suites. They tried to sanitize it in the suites. It started in the streets, and that's where the battle got to stay.
Reverend Al, I got to tell you, so much to talk to you about, man. Thank you for coming to the big show, the Fat Joe Show. Shout out Rachel Noy. She was pushing for this, too. Right. My mother's watching. My aunts is watching. Everybody loves you, Reverend Al, right?
Well, I love them.
In my family, we love you.
Well, but I love you.
Reverend Al, where you grew up exactly when you was a young kid?
I grew up in Brownsville in Brooklyn. And when Brownsville was considered the roughest place in the city. And I was a boy preacher, but I was friends with everybody. And they used to have a gang out there called the Tomahawks. Some of the old bloods from the Tomahawks come to my rallies now. But we grew up together. And we had one brother named Smiley that was one of the heavy guys in the Tomahawks. And he had a little guy used to hang on the roof, hanging out, taking care of pigeons. And we used to laugh at him because he'd run behind Smiley. And he grew up, became the heavyweight champion of the world, Mike Tyson. That's the hood I come out of.
I want to know what makes you so passionate about the people, the cause. Like what hits you in your life? Because you have given your whole life to this. What makes you so passionate about the cause, Reverend Al? What made you, what clicked in your brain that said, I got to fight for the people?
I started as a boy preacher in the Pentecostal church. And I started seeing people getting hurt because if we went to certain neighborhoods in the 80s, it was Howard Beach. And I was saying, we can't just preach about this. We got to go out there and do something about it. And they said, well, you know, it might have been something else. So I got the idea. I said, you know what? We know it ain't something else. They don't want us in them neighborhoods. So I called a march in Howard Beach. Why? Because I knew if we went out there, the folk in the neighborhood would come out and show the world you had certain sections you couldn't go in. We went out there and marched, and sure enough, all the neighbors came out. They started calling us the N-word, waving bananas at us. And the whole world understood it was racism because people thought racism was in the South. But we knew in New York, in Philly, around the country, in the North, there was that kind of racism. So my thing is, one led to another, and I just got lost in the movement. I found my zone. It's like you in the studio. My zone was I was going to fight for people because my father left when I was 10. My mother raised me on food stamps and welfare, and nobody stood up for her. And I was going to fight for people. I didn't know how I was going to make a living. I preach on Sunday, but I figured that, hey, we preach faith, live by faith, and it grew up. They come after me many times, many accusations, but I never stopped, and I ain't going to stop. Even now, I'm considered a little more successful, got a show on MSNBC and all that, but I'm still there for George Floyd. I'm still there for Ahmaud Arbery, because this is what I'm about. The two most important dates in your life, Fat Joe, is the day you was born and the day you find out why you was born. I know why I was born, and that's what I do.
Let's take it back to that march. Didn't you get stabbed in that march, Reverend Al?
I got stabbed in Bensonhurst. A kid named Yusef Hawkins went in a place called Bensonhurst section of Brooklyn, and they killed him. I mean, he got off the train, stopped early. We're going to come out.
I remember Yusef Hawkins when I'm walking. Shout out to Chubb Rock. I'll never forget that.
That's right. That's right. And I led 23 marches there. One guy couldn't take it no more. Every week they was out there calling us names. One guy slipped through the police line, stuck a knife in my chest right here. And they rushed me to the hospital. Obviously, I survived. And, you know, it's funny you asked me about that because that was 91. And when I laid in that gurney in Coney Island Hospital, I made up my mind. I didn't know how serious the wound was or not. And I made up my mind that now I know I mean it, because if I get up off this bed, I'm going to keep marching. You don't know whether you really mean it till all the chips are down and you still say, I ain't going to back up. And then the other part is in when you get successful and people say, oh, you got a TV show now. Oh, you got this, that, and that. Oh, Obama likes me, go to the White House. And I still kept marching. I did Trayvon. I did Eric Garner while I was doing my TV show. So you got to be tested with the worst time and the best time, and you find out that's your zone. And there are people that are listening to you, Fat Joe, that won't listen to guys like me. That's why you're here. There are people that will listen to me on your show that won't never turn on MSNBC. You're a vessel, because the message don't have one messenger, but it's one message, and we all got to carry that message, and we all got to fight for each other.
Brent, while I'm talking to you, I just had like an epiphany, and I think of the movie Malcolm X, and where everybody was in the middle of the block, and everybody was preaching, talking their thing. Was it really like that in Harlem back in the days, Brent?
Well, you know, it happened. Yeah, when I was growing up, it was. They'd have people on the corners and speaking. But what happened, Spike Lee, all of us grew up in Brooklyn. We were around the same age. I talked Spike Lee.
Brother.
And Spike said, Rev, I want you to do a scene in Malcolm X. I said, Spike, I was 9 years old. Malcolm got killed. I didn't know Malcolm. He said, that's right, I want to throw you in a scene. So I get to the set. Denzel Washington's playing Malcolm. Bobby Seale, who was one of the founders of the Black Panther Party, was himself. And then I was there as a street corner preacher, as myself, even though I wasn't old enough to have been back then. So Spike said, get on the ladder. And he pointed to Denzel, and Denzel started doing the Malcolm speech. Then points to Bobby Seale. Bobby Seale doing the Panther rap. And he pointed to me, and I said, like this, I didn't have no script. He said, just do you. And I did me. So people see the Malcolm X movie, think that was scripted. That was us freestyling. But that's what they used to do. And that's the community I grew up in. Some were Muslim, some were Christian, some were this, some were that. And we all had different tactics, and we debate. But everybody had the same goal. And that, like I said, only ones was the ones fronting. They ain't going to do a night in jail. They ain't going to march. They ain't going to do nothing. They're going to talk about what I wouldn't have took. And they taking it every day. They big and bad on Twitter. And they meek and lowly by the water cooler in the job. And everybody know they're fraud. They big and bad. Yeah. And stuff. But they go to the job and say yes, sir.
Yeah, bro.
And no,
yeah,
sir. Baby. And all that. Yeah. That's all that is. Frauds. Don't worry about them.